So far, we have solved three examples on separation of variables. And those three examples were in the Cartesian coordinates. When we are having plane geometries, then Cartesian coordinates are the best to work with. When we solved example 3.3 and example 3.4, they were basically two-dimensional problems. While in example 3.5, we had a three-dimensional problem. Now, when a geometry is not a planar geometry, like not consisting of planes, but it is having a certain curvature, then we go to the non-Cartesian coordinates, and then it depends on the geometry. Whether the geometry is spherical, then we go for the spherical polar coordinates, and if the geometry is cylindrical, then we go for the cylindrical polar coordinates. We have already discussed the spherical polar coordinates and the cylindrical polar coordinates in chapter 1, and you may review it before proceeding with this section. It is to be kept in mind that dealing with the spherical polar coordinates here in this Griffiths electrodynamics, it has not solved all the parameters involved in the second order differential equation. However, we have solved them at two places, one in quantum mechanics, and I am sharing with you the link to those lectures, where you can see that when we are solving the Schrodinger wave equation, it's also a second order differential equation, and we solve every bit of it. And over there, we also limit ourselves to some extent, because we are interested in the quantum numbers and we restrict ourselves only to that one. A very thorough and comprehensive treatment we have done in the classical electrodynamics by J.D. Jackson, and is the subject is electrodynamics, so we have done all the calculations of all the parameters we have done over there. So few things that are very clear, that when we solve a spherical geometry, a second order differential equation on a spherical geometry, then we are having the solutions is Legendre polynomials, and then if we include the azimuthal symmetry, because we are having r, theta and phi, when we include the azimuthal symmetry, then we are having associated Legendre polynomials, and then the theta and the phi component gives us the spherical harmonics. Similarly, in the same situation, when we are solving a cylindrical geometry problem, second order differential equation, then we are having the Bessel functions, the associated Bessel functions, and then the cylindrical harmonics. So these things is a summary. And here in introductory level electrodynamics, we are not going into that much detail, but we are solving in a very simple manner the spherical polar coordinates. Here are the second order differential equation in the spherical polar coordinates. So let me start with this one. This is section 3.3.2, and the title is Spherical Coordinates. As we know that in spherical polar coordinates, we are having the three variables r, theta and phi. This is the radial one, and this is the zenith angle, or the angular portion, and this is also the angular, but this is called the azimuthal, because r is the radius which goes from center to somewhere, and then theta is the one which goes from 0 to pi. covering a semicircle like this, and then phi goes along here to make a complete sphere. So our potential will also be a function of r, theta and phi. Although in this section we will consider our potential not to be a function of phi, but it is generalized. In generalized form it is like this. So for any curved geometry, when things are not involved with planes calculation, then we are having the spherical polar coordinates in action. We know that the second order differential equation del square phi, the Laplace equation del square phi equal to zero. Now this del square we will write in the form of in the spherical polar coordinates, and this is basically equal to 1 over r square curly over curly r, and then r square partial over partial r plus 1 over r square sine theta and partial by partial theta, and here sine theta partial by partial theta plus 1 over r square sine of square theta and partial square over partial phi squared. And this is the value, this is the del square we have converted from Cartesian into spherical polar coordinates. So when we apply here, means we denote this with the phi del square phi equal to zero, but in Griffiths we are having the terminology is del square v equal to zero. This is the Jackson terminology that we are having for potential phi. So our equation will become that we will have to just multiply with this the v, and then this implies in spherical polar coordinates I can write 1 over r square curly by curly r, and then r square partial v over partial r, and plus 1 over r square sine theta and partial by partial theta sine theta partial v over partial theta plus 1 over r square sine square theta and partial square v over partial phi squared is equal to 0. So this is what we are having the equation. Now when we consider the azimuthal symmetry, azimuthal symmetry means that the potential is only depending on r and theta, and it is independent of phi. So means it is constant on phi. Like when we are just make this thing here, that if it's a spherical surface, then r will be from some point to the radius of it, this is r. So the potential is depending on r. As we change r, then the potential is varying. And this angle is called theta angle, and this is from here to here. It means that when this angle is changing, this is angle theta. So when this angle is changing, the potential is changing as well. But when the potential is going around here in the sphere, then the potential is basically not changing. When we are going at any point, at any value of r and theta, when we go around the sphere, then the potential is not changing. The potential is the same. And this we call the azimuthal symmetry, or this we call it, this kind of rotation symmetry is there, not this one, just like longitude and latitude. So we have, then our equation becomes very simple, that when this term goes to zero, then we are left with 1 over r square and partial by partial r square partial v over partial r plus 1 over r square sine theta and partial by partial theta and sine of theta partial v over partial theta is equal to zero. Now r square is here. If I do multiply both sides with r, then r square is gone from here. So this one is gone and this one is gone, and we are left with, this implies that partial over partial r and r square partial v over partial r plus 1 over sine of theta and partial over partial theta sine of theta here and partial over partial theta of v, and this thing is equal to zero. Now we are in a position to use the separation of variable techniques, because we have separated this thing into r dependent and into theta dependent only. So now it can be separated very easily, and we suppose that the potential, which is a function of r and theta, is equal to two potentials. The one potential I am writing is capital R, which is a function of R, and the other potential which I write is big theta, and it's a function of theta. Keep in mind, capital R and capital theta are basically the potentials. So this thing, if I write without the variables, then this is R and theta. So here I put this thing, for V I put this thing. Now what will happen when I will put this, then this implies that when R and theta will come in here, then theta will come outside because it is not depending on R, and R will remain here. So here we will have theta outside, and here we will have, when I write here, the value of V is theta, R and theta, then theta will remain here and R will come outside. So R will be here. And further, is theta is here and R is here. So if I divide this value by R theta, means this one, then theta theta will cancel and 1 over R will be here. 1 over R will remain, and then partial over partial R and R square partial R over partial R here plus here 1 over theta will come in, and 1 over theta here and sine of theta partial over partial theta and sine of theta and partial theta over partial theta here, and this thing is equal to zero. Now in this equation, as we have separated the radial component and we have separated the angular component, now when they sum up, then they are equal to zero. So these are variable, these are functions, and functions, when we say that functions, when add up, they equal to zero, so we consider them equal to a constant. if this is a constant C, then this will be constant with a minus C here. And this constant I take a bit tricky, or a fancier constant, and I write this constant is equal to L into L plus 1. This is the constant, means again it's a constant. If L is a constant, then L square plus 1 is also a constant, but writing it in this form will make our solution easier. And this is what which Legendre did in his solution. And here this thing minus C will be equal to L into L plus 1. So when C is here, then minus L into L plus 1. So I can write that now my equation is such that